The Crusade of the Excelsior. By Bret Harte. Podcast 2 of 9. Part 1. In Bonds. Chapter 3. Vigilancia. Without exchanging another word with his escort, Senor Perkins followed him to the main hatch, where they descended and groped their way through the half-obscurity of the lower deck. Here they passed one or two shadows, that, recognizing the Senor, seemed to draw aside in a half-awed, half-suppressed shyness, as of caged animals in the presence of their trainer. At the forehatch they again descended, passing a figure that appeared to be keeping watch at the foot of the ladder, and almost instantly came upon a group lit up by the glare of a bull's-eye lantern. It was composed of the first and second mate, a vicious-looking Peruvian sailor with a bandaged head, and, to the Senor's astonishment, the missing passenger Hurlstone, seated on the deck, heavily ironed. "Tell him what you know, Pedro," said the first mate to the Peruvian sailor curtly. "It was just daybreak, Patrono, before we put about," began the man in Spanish, "that I thought I saw someone gliding along towards the forehatch, but I lost sight of him. After we had tumbled up to go on the other tack, I heard a noise in the forehold. I went down and found him," pointing to Hurlstone, "hiding there. He had some provisions stowed away beside him, and that package. I grabbed him, Patrono. He broke away and struck me here." He pointed to his still wet bandage and would have got out overboard through the port, but the second mate heard the row and came down just in time to stop him. "When was this?" asked Senor Perkins. "Guardia de Diana. You were chattering, you fellows. Quien sabe," said the Peruvian, lifting his shoulders. "How does he explain himself?" "He refuses to speak." "Take off his irons," said Senor Perkins, in English. "But," expostulated the first mate, with a warning gesture. "I said take off his irons," repeated Senor Perkins in a dry and unfamiliar voice. The two mates released the shackles. The prisoner raised his eyes to Senor Perkins. He was a slightly built man of about 30, fair-haired and hollow-cheeked. His short upper lip was lifted over his teeth, as if from hurried or labored breathing, but his features were regular and determined, and his large blue eyes shone with a strange abstraction of courage and fatuity. "That will do," continued the Senor, in the same tone. "Now leave him with me." The two mates looked at each other, and hesitated, but at a glance from Perkins, turned, and ascended the ladder again. The Peruvian alone remained. "Go," said the Senor sharply. The man cast a vindictive look at the prisoner and retreated sullenly. "Did he tell you," said the prisoner, looking after the sailor grimly, "that I tried to bribe him to let me go, but that I couldn't reach his figure? He wanted too much. He thought I had some stolen money or valuables here," he added, with a bitter laugh, pointing to the package that lay beside him. "And you hadn't," said Perkins shortly. "No. I believe you. And now, my young friend," said Perkins, with a singular return of his beaming gentleness, "since those two efficient and competent officers and this energetic but discourteous seaman are gone, would you mind telling me what you were hiding for?" The prisoner raised his eyes on his questioner. For the last 3 weeks he had lived in the small community of which the Senor was a prominent member, but he scarcely recognized him now. "What if I refuse?" he said. The Senor shrugged his shoulders. "Those two excellent men would feel it their duty to bring the Peruvian to the captain, and I should be called to interpret to him. And I should throw myself overboard the first chance I got. I would have done so 10 minutes ago, but the mate stopped me." His eye glistened with the same fatuous determination he had shown at first. There was no doubt he would do as he said. "I believe you would," said the Senor benevolently, "but I see no present necessity for that, nor for any trouble whatever, if you will kindly tell me what I am to say." The young man's eyes fell. "I did try to conceal myself in the hold," he said bluntly. "I intended to remain there hidden while the ship was at Mazatlan. I did not know until now that the vessel had changed her course." "And how did you believe your absence would be accounted for?" asked the senior blandly. I thought it would be supposed that I had fallen overboard before we entered Mazatlan. So that anybody seeking you there would not find you, and you would be believed to be dead.
Yes.
He raised his eyes quickly to Senor Perkins again. I am neither a thief nor a murderer, he said almost savagely, but I do not choose to be recognized by anyone who knows me on this side of the grave. Senor Perkins' eyes sought his, and for an instant seemed to burn through the singular, fatuous mist that veiled them. My friend, he said cheerfully, after a moment's pause, you have just had a providential escape. I repeated a most providential escape. Indeed, if I were inclined to prophesy, I would say you were a man reserved for some special good fortune. The prisoner stared at him with angry amazement. You are a confirmed somnambulist. Excuse me, continued the senor, with a soft, deprecating gesture, you are, of course, unaware of it. Most victims of that singular complaint are, or at least fail to recognize the extent of their aberration. In your case it has only been indicated by a profound melancholy and natural shunning of society. In a paroxysm of your disorder, you rise in the night, fully dress yourself, and glide as unconsciously along the deck in pursuance of some vague fancy. You pass the honest but energetic sailor who has just left us, who thinks you are a phantom, and fails to give the alarm. You are precipitated by a lurch of the ship through an open hatchway, the shock renders you insensible until you are discovered and restored. And who will believe this pretty story? Said the young man scornfully. The honest sailor who picked you up, who has related it in his own picturesque tongue to me, who will in turn interpret it to the captain and the other passengers, replied Senor Perkins blandly. And what of the two mates who were here? Said the prisoner hesitatingly. They are two competent officers, who are quite content to carry out the orders of their superiors, and who understand their duty too well to interfere with the reports of their subordinates, on which these orders are based. Mr. Brooks, the first officer, though fairly intelligent and a good reader of history, is only imperfectly acquainted with the languages, and Mr. McCarthy's knowledge of Spanish is confined to a few objurgations which generally preclude extended conversation. And who are you, said Hurlstone, more calmly, who are willing to do this for a stranger? A friend equally of yours, the captain's, and the other passengers, replied Senor Perkins pleasantly. A man who believes you, my dear sir, and, even if he did not, sees no reason to interrupt the harmony that has obtained in our little community during our delightful passage. Were any scandal to occur, were you to carry out your idea of throwing yourself overboard, it would, to say nothing of my personal regret, produce a discord for which there is no necessity, and from which no personal good can be derived. Here at least your secret is secure, for even I do not ask what it is, we meet here on an equality, based on our own conduct and courtesy to each other, limited by no antecedent prejudice, and restrained by no thought of the future. In a little while we shall be separated. Why should it not be as friends? Why should we not look back upon our little world of this ship as a happy one? Hurlstone gazed at the speaker with a troubled air. It was once more the quaint benevolent figure whom he had vaguely noted among the other passengers, and as vaguely despised. He hesitated a moment, and then, half timidly, half reservedly, extended his hand. I thank you, he said, at least for not asking my secret. Perhaps, if it was only your own you might tell it, interrupted the senor, gaily. I understand. I see you recognize my principle. There is no necessity of your putting yourself to that pain, or another to that risk. And now, my young friend, time presses. I must say a word to our friends above, who are waiting, and I shall see that you are taken privately to your stateroom while most of the other passengers are still on deck. If you would permit yourself the weakness of allowing the steward to carry or assist you, it would be better. Let me advise you that the excitement of the last 3 hours has not left you in your full strength. You must really give me the pleasure of spreading the glad tidings of your safety among the passengers, who have been so terribly alarmed. They will undoubtedly be relieved, said Hurlstone, with iron-icle bitterness. You wrong them, returned the seigneur, with gentle reproach, especially the ladies. The voice of the first mate from above here checked his further speech, and, perhaps, prevented him, as he quickly reascended the upper deck, from noticing the slight embarrassment of his prisoner. The seigneur's explanations to the mate were evidently explicit and brief. In a few moments he reappeared with the steward and his assistant. Lean on these men, he said to Hurlstone significantly, and do not overestimate your strength. Thank heaven, no bones are broken, and you are only bruised by the fall. With a little rest, I think we can get along without laying the captain's medicine chest under contribution. Our kind friend Mr. Brooks has had the lower deck cleared, so that you may gain your stateroom without alarming the passengers or fatiguing yourself. He pressed Hurlstone's hand as the latter resigned himself to the steward, and was half led, half supported, through the gloom of the lower deck. Senor Perkins remained for an instant gazing after him with even more than his usual benevolence. Suddenly his arm was touched almost rudely. He turned, and encountered the lowering eyes of the Peruvian sailor. And what is to be done for me, said the man roughly, in Spanish. You. Yes. Who's to pay for this, he pointed to his bandaged head. Without changing his bland expression, Senor Perkins apparently allowed his soft black eyes to rest, as if fondly, on the angry pupils of the Peruvian. The eyes of the latter presently sought the ground. My dear Yato, said Senor Perkins softly, I scarcely think that this question of personal damage can be referred to the state. I will, however, look into it. Meantime, let me advise you to control your enthusiasm. Too much zeal in a subordinate is even more fatal than laxity. For the rest, son, be vigilant and peaceful. Thou hast meant well, much shall be forgiven thee. For the present, vamos. He turned on his heel, and ascended to the upper deck. Here he found the passengers thrilling with a vague excitement. A few brief orders, a few briefer explanations, dropped by the officers, had already whetted curiosity to the keenest point. The seigneur was instantly beset with interrogations. Gentle, compassionate, with well-rounded periods, he related the singular accident that had befallen Mr. Hurlstone, and his providential escape from almost certain death. At the most, he has now only the exhaustion of the shock, from which a day of perfect rest will recover him, but, he added deprecatingly, at present he ought not to be disturbed or excited. The story was received by those fellow passengers who had been strongest in their suspicions of Hurlstone's suicide or flight, with a keen sense of discomfiture, only mitigated by a humorous perception of the cause of the accident. It was agreed that a man whose ludicrous infirmity had been the cause of putting the ship out of her course, and the passengers out of their comfortable security, could not be wronged by attributing to him manlier and more criminal motives. A somnambulist on shipboard was clearly a humorous object, who might, however, become a bore. It all accounts for his being so deuced quiet and reserved in the daytime, said Crosby facetiously, he couldn't keep it up the whole 24 hours. If he'd only given us a little more of his company when he was awake, he wouldn't have gollivanted round at night, and we'd have been 30 miles nearer port. Equal amusement was created by the humorous suggestion that the unfortunate man had never been entirely awake during the voyage, and that he would now, probably for the first time, really make the acquaintance of his fellow voyagers. Listening to this badinage with bland tolerance, Senor Perkins no doubt felt that, for the maintenance of that perfect amity he so ardently apostrophized, it was just as well that Hurlstone was in his stateroom, and out of hearing. He would have been more satisfied, however, had he been permitted to hear the feminine comments on this incident. In the eyes of the lady passengers, Mr. Hurlstone was more a hero than ever. His mysterious malady invested him with a vague and spiritual interest, his escape from the awful fate reserved to him, in their excited fancy, gave him the éclat of having actually survived it, while the supposed real incident of his fall through the hatchway lent him the additional luster of a wounded and crippled man. That prostrate condition of active humanity, which so irresistibly appeals to the feminine imagination as segregating their victim from the distractions of his own sex, and, as it were, delivering him helpless into their hands, was at once their opportunity, and his. All the ladies volunteered to nurse him. It was with difficulty that Mrs. Brimmer and Mrs. Markham, reinforced with bandages, flannels, and liniments, and supported by different theories, could be kept from the door of his stateroom. Jellies, potted meats, and delicacies from their private stores appeared on trays at his bedside, to be courteously declined by the Seigneur Perkins, in his new functions of a benevolent type of Sancho Panza physician. To say that this pleased the gentle optimism of the Seigneur is unnecessary. Even while his companion writhed under the sting of this enforced compassion, the good man beamed philosophically upon him. "Take care, or I shall end this cursed farce in my own way," said Hurlstone ominously, his eyes again filming with a vague desperation. "My dear boy," returned the Seigneur gently, "reflect upon the situation. Your suffering, real or implied, produces in the hearts of these gentle creatures a sympathy which not only exalts and sustains their higher natures, but, I conscientiously believe, gratifies and pleases their lower ones. Why should you deny them this opportunity of indulging their twofold organisms, and beguiling the tedium of the voyage, merely because of some erroneous exhibition of fact?" Later, Seigneur Perkins might have added to this exposition the singularly stimulating effect which Hurlstone's supposed peculiarity had upon the feminine imagination. But there were some secrets which were not imparted even to him, and it was only to each other that the ladies confided certain details and reminiscences. For it now appeared that they had all heard strange noises and stealthy steps at night, and Mrs. Brimmer was quite sure that on one occasion the handle of her stateroom door was softly turned. Mrs. Markham also remembered distinctly that only a week before, being unable to sleep, she had ventured out into the saloon in a dressing gown to get her diary, which she had left with a portfolio on a chair, that she had a sudden consciousness of another presence in the saloon, although she could distinguish nothing by the dim light of the swinging lantern, and that, after quickly returning to her room, she was quite positive she heard a door close. But the most surprising reminiscence developed by the late incident was from Mrs. Brimmer's nurse, Susan. As it, apparently, demonstrated the fact that Mr. Hurlstone not only walked but talked in his sleep, it possessed a more mysterious significance. It seemed that Susan was awakened one night by the sound of voices, and, opening her door softly, saw a figure which she at first supposed to be the Seigneur Perkins, but which she now was satisfied was poor Mr. Hurlstone. As there was no one else to be seen, the voices must have proceeded from that single figure, and being in a strange and unknown tongue, were inexpressibly weird and awful. When pressed to remember what was said, she could only distinguish one word, a woman's name, Virgil Vigil, no, Virginesia. It must have been one of those creatures at Calau, whose pictures you can buy for 10 cents, said Mrs. Brimmer. If it is one of them, Susan must have made a mistake in the first two syllables of the name, said Mrs. Markham grimly. But surely, Miss Keene, said Miss Chubb, turning to that young lady, who had taken only the part of a passive listener to this colloquy, and was gazing over the railing at the sinking sun, surely you can tell us something about this poor young man. If I don't mistake, you are the only person he ever honored with his conversation. And only once, I think, said the young girl, slightly coloring. He happened to be sitting next to me on deck, and I believe he spoke only out of politeness. At least, he seemed very quiet and reserved, and talked on general topics, and I thought very intelligently. I should have thought, I mean, she continued hesitatingly, I thought he was an educated gentleman. That isn't at all inconsistent with photographs or sleepwalking, said Mrs. Brimmer, with one of her vague simplicities. Uncle Quincy brought home a whole sheaf of those women whom he said he'd met, and one of my cousins, who was educated at Heidelberg, used to walk in his sleep, as it were, all over Europe. Did you notice anything queer in his eyes, Miss Keene? Asked Miss Chubb vivaciously. Miss Keene had noticed that his eyes were his best feature, albeit somewhat abstracted and melancholy, but, For some vague reason she could not explain herself, she answered hurriedly that she had seen nothing very particular in them. "Well," said Mrs. Markham positively, "when he's able to be out again, I shall consider it my duty to look him up, and try to keep him sufficiently awake in the daytime to ensure his resting better at night." "No one can do it, dear Mrs. Markham, better than you, and no one would think of misunderstanding your motives," said Mrs. Brimmer sweetly. "But it's getting late, and the air seems to be ever so much colder. Captain Bunker says it's because we are really nearing the Californian coast. It seems so odd. Mr. Brimmer wrote to me that it was so hot in Sacramento that you could do something with eggs in the sun, I forget what."
"Hatch them," suggested Miss Chubb.
"I think so," returned Mrs. Brimmer, rising. "Let us go below." The three ladies rustled away, but Miss Keene, throwing a wrap around her shoulders, lingered by the railing. With one little hand supporting her round chin, she leaned over the darkly heaving water. She was thinking of her brief and only interview with that lonely man whose name was now in everybody's mouth, but who, until today, had been passed over by them with an unconcern equal to his own. And yet to her refined and delicately feminine taste there appeared no reason why he should not have mingled with his fellows, and have accepted the homage from them that she was instinctively ready to give. He seemed to her like a gentleman and something more. In her limited but joyous knowledge of the world and knowledge gathered in the happy school life of an orphan who but faintly remembered and never missed a parent's care, she knew nothing of the mysterious dominance of passion, suffering, or experience in fashioning the outward expression of men, and saw only that Mr. Hurlstone was unlike any other. That unlikeness was fascinating. He had said very little to her in that very brief period. He had not talked to her with the general gallantry which she already knew her prettiness elicited. Without knowing why, she felt there was a subtle flattery in his tacit recognition of that other self of which she, as yet, knew so little. She could not remember what they had talked about nor why. Nor was she offended that he had never spoken to her since, nor gone beyond a grave lifting of his hat to her when he passed. Chapter 4. In the fog. By noon of the following day the coast of the peninsula of California had been sighted to leeward. The lower temperature of the northwest trades had driven Mrs. Brimmer and Miss Chubb into their staterooms to consult their wardrobes in view of an impending change from the light muslins and easy languid toilets of the tropics. That momentous question for the moment held all other topics in abeyance, and even Mrs. Markham and Miss Keene, though they still kept the deck in shawls and wraps, sighed over this feminine evidence of the gentle passing of their summer holiday. The gentlemen had already mounted their pea jackets and overcoats, with the single exception of Senor Perkins, who, in chivalrous compliment to the elements, still bared his unfettered throat and forehead to the breeze. The aspect of the coast, as seen from the Excelsior's deck, seemed to bear out Mr. Banks' sweeping indictment of the day before. A few low, dome-like hills, yellow and treeless as sand dunes, scarcely raised themselves above the horizon. The air, too, appeared to have taken upon itself a dry asperity, the sun shone with a hard, practical brilliancy. Miss Keene raised her eyes to Senor Perkins with a pretty impatience that she sometimes indulged in, as one of the privileges of accepted beauty and petted youth. "I don't think much of your peninsula," she said poutingly. "It looks dreadfully flat and uninteresting. It was a great deal nicer on the other coast, or even at sea." "Perhaps you are judging hastily, my dear young friend," said Senor Perkins, with habitual tolerance. "I have heard that behind those hills, and hidden from sight in some of the canyons, are perfect little Edens of beauty and fruitfulness. They are like some ardent natures that cover their approaches with the ashes of their burnt-up fires, but only do it the better to keep intact their glowing, vivifying, central heat." "How very poetical, Mr. Perkins," said Mrs. Markham, with blunt admiration. "You ought to put that into verse."
"I have," returned Senor Perkins modestly. "They are some reflections on, I hardly dare call them an apostrophe to, the crater of Colima. If you will permit me to read them to you this evening, I shall be charmed." I hope also to take that opportunity of showing you the verses of a gifted woman, not yet known to fame, Mrs. Euphemia M. Corkle, of Peoria, Illinois. Mrs. Markham coughed slightly. The gifted M. Corkle was already known to her through certain lines quoted by the seigneur, and the entire cabin had one evening fled before a larger and more ambitious manuscript of the fair Illinoisian. Miss Keene, who dreaded the reappearance of this poetical phantom that seemed to haunt the seigneur's fancy, could not, however, forget that she had been touched on that occasion by a kindly moisture of eye and tremulousness of voice in the reader, and, in spite of the hopeless bathos of the composition, she had forgiven him. Though she did not always understand Seigneur Perkins, she liked him too well to allow him to become ridiculous to others, and at the present moment she promptly interposed with a charming assumption of coquetry. "You forget that you promised to let me read the manuscript first, and in private, and that you engaged to give me my revenge at chess this evening. But do as you like. You are all fast becoming faithless. I suppose it is because our holiday is drawing to a close, and we shall soon forget we ever had any, or be ashamed we ever played so long. Everybody seems to be getting nervous and fidgety and preparing for civilization again. Mr. Banks, for the last few days, has dressed himself regularly as if he were going downtown to his office, and writes letters in the corner of the saloon as if it were a counting house. Mr. Crosby and Mr. Winslow do nothing but talk of their prospects, and I believe they are drawing up articles of partnership together. Here is Mr. Brace frightening me by telling me that my brother will lock me up, to keep the rich miners from laying their bags of gold dust at my feet, and Mrs. Brimmer and Miss Chubb assure me that I haven't a decent gown to go ashore in. You forget Mr. Hurlstone, said Brace, with ill-concealed bitterness, he seems to have time enough on his hands, and I dare say would sympathize with you. You women like idle men. If we do, it's because only the idle men have the time to amuse us, retorted Miss Keene. But, she added, with a laugh, I suppose I'm getting nervous and fidgety myself, for I find myself every now and then watching the officers and men, and listening to the orders as if something were going to happen again. I never felt so before, I never used to have the least concern in what you call the working of the ship, and now her voice, which had been half playful, half pettish, suddenly became grave, and now look at the mate and those men forward. There certainly is something going on, or is going to happen. What are they looking at? The mate had clambered halfway up the main ratlins, and was looking earnestly to windward. Two or three of the crew on the forecastle were gazing in the same direction. The group of cabin passengers on the quarter deck, following their eyes, saw what appeared to be another low shore on the opposite bow. Why? There's another coast there, said Mrs. Markham. It's a fog bank, said Senor Perkins gravely. He quickly crossed the deck, exchanged a few words with the officer, and returned. Miss Keene, who had felt a sense of relief, nevertheless questioned his face as he again stood beside her. But he had recovered his beaming cheerfulness. It's nothing to alarm you, he said, answering her glance, but it may mean delay if we can't get out of it. You don't mind that, I know. No, replied the young girl, smiling. Besides, it would be a new experience. We've had winds and calms, we only want fog now to complete our adventures. Unless it's going to make everybody cross, she continued, with a mischievous glance at Brace. You'll find it won't improve the temper of the officers, said Crosby, who had joined the group. There's nothing sailors hate more than a fog. They can go to sleep in a hurricane between the rolls of a ship, but a fog keeps them awake. It's the one thing they can't shirk. There's the skipper tumbled up, too. The old man looks wrathy, don't he? But it's no use now, we're going slap into it, and the wind's failing. It was true. In the last few moments all that vast glistening surface of metallic blue which stretched so far to windward appeared to be slowly eaten away as if by some dull, corroding acid. The distant horizon line of sea and sky was still distinct and sharply cut, but the whole water between them had grown gray, as if some invisible shadow had passed in mid-air across it. The actual fog bank had suddenly lost its resemblance to the shore, had lifted as a curtain, and now seemed suspended over the ship. Gradually it descended, the topgallant and topsails were lost in this mysterious vapor, yet the horizon line still glimmered faintly. Then another mist seemed to rise from the sea and meet it. In another instant the deck whereon they stood shrank to the appearance of a raft adrift in a faint gray sea. With the complete obliteration of all circumambient space, the wind fell. Their isolation was complete. It was notable that the first and most peculiar effect of this misty environment was the absolute silence. The empty, invisible sails above did not flap, the sheets and halyards hung limp, even the faint creaking of an unseen block overhead was so startling as to draw every eye upwards. Muffled orders from viewless figures forward were obeyed by phantoms that moved noiselessly through the gray sea that seemed to have invaded the deck. Even the passengers spoke in whispers, or held their breath, in passive groups, as if fearing to break a silence so replete with awe and anticipation. It was next noticed that the vessel was subjected to some vague motion, the resistance of the water had ceased, the waves no longer hissed under her bows, or nestled and lapped under her counter, a dreamy, irregular, and listless rocking had taken the place of the regular undulations. At times, a faint and half-delicious vertigo seemed to overcome their senses, the ship was drifting. Captain Bunker stood near the bitts, where his brief orders were transmitted to the man at the almost useless wheel. At his side Senor Perkins beamed with unshaken serenity, and hopefully replied to the captain's half-surly, half-anxious queries. "By the chart we should be well east of Los Lobos Island, D.S.C.," he said impatiently. "You don't happen to remember the direction of the current offshore when you were running up here?" "It's 5 years ago," said the senor modestly, "but I remember we kept well to the west to weather Cape San Eugenio. My impression is that there was a strong northwesterly current setting north of Balenos Bay." "And we're in it now," said Captain Bunker shortly. "How near San Roque does it set?" "Within a mile or two." "I should keep away more to the west," said Senor Perkins, "and clear." "I ain't asking you to run the ship," interrupted Captain Bunker sharply. "How's her head now, Mr. Brooks?" The seaman standing near cast a rapid glance at Senor Perkins, but not a muscle of his bland face moved or betrayed a consciousness of the insult. Whatever might have been the feeling towards him, at that moment the sailors after their fashion admired their captain, strong, masterful, and imperious. The danger that had cleared his eye, throat, and brain, and left him once more the daring and skillful navigator they knew, wiped out of their shallow minds the vicious habit that had sunk him below their level. It had now become perceptible to even the inexperienced eyes of the passengers that the Excelsior was obeying some new and profound impulse. The vague drifting had ceased, and in its place had come a mysterious but regular movement, in which the surrounding mist seemed to participate, until fog and vessel moved together towards some unseen but well-defined bourne. In vain had the boats of the Excelsior, manned by her crew, endeavored with a towing line to check or direct the inexplicable movement, in vain had Captain Bunker struggled, with all the skilled weapons of seamanship, against his invincible foe, wrapped in the impenetrable fog, the ship moved ghost-like to what seemed to be her doom. The anxiety of the officers had not as yet communicated itself to the passengers. Those who had been most nervous in the ordinary onset of wind and wave looked upon the fog as a phenomenon whose only disturbance might be delay. To Miss Keene this conveyed no annoyance, rather that placid envelopment of cloud soothed her fancy. She submitted herself to its soft embraces, and to the mysterious onward movement of the ship, as if it were part of a youthful dream. Once she thought of the ship of Sinbad, and that fatal lodestone mountain, with an awe that was, however, half a pleasure. "You are not frightened, Miss Keene," said a voice near her. She started slightly. It was the voice of Mr. Hurlstone. So thick was the fog that his face and figure appeared to come dimly out of it, like a part of her dreaming fancy. Without replying to his question, she said quickly, "You are better then, Mr. Hurlstone? We were all so frightened for you." An angry shadow crossed his thin face, and he hesitated. After a pause he recovered himself, and said, I was saying you were taking all this very quietly. I don't think there's much danger myself. And if we should go ashore here?
Well, suggested Miss Keene, ignoring this first intimation of danger in her surprise at the man's manner.
Well, we should all be separated only a few days earlier, that's all.
More frightened at the strange bitterness of his voice than by the sense of physical peril, she was vaguely moving away towards the dimly outlined figures of her companions when she was arrested by a voice forward. There was a slight murmur among the passengers.
What did he say? Asked Miss Keene. What are breakers ahead?
Hurlstone did not reply.
Where away? Asked a second voice.
The murmur still continuing, Captain Bunker's hoarse voice pierced the gloom silence fore and aft.
The first voice repeated faintly.
On the larboard bow.
There was another silence.
Again the voice repeated, as if mechanically.
Breakers.
Where away?
On the starboard beam.
We are in some passage or channel, said Hurlstone quietly.
The young girl glanced round her and saw for the first time that, in one of those inexplicable movements she had not understood, the other passengers had been withdrawn into a limited space of the deck, as if through some authoritative orders, while she and her companion had been evidently overlooked.
A couple of sailors, who had suddenly taken their positions by the quarter boats, strengthened the accidental separation.
Is there someone taking care of you? He asked, half hesitatingly, Mr. Brace Perkins or?
No, she replied quickly.
Why?
Well, we are very near the boat in an emergency, and you might allow me to stay here and see you safe in it.
But the other ladies?
Mrs. Markham, and?
They'll take their turn after you, he said grimly, picking up a wrap from the railing and throwing it over her shoulders.
But I don't understand, she stammered, more embarrassed by the situation than by any impending peril.
There is very little danger, I think, he added impatiently.
There is scarcely any sea, the ship has very little way on, and these breakers are not over rocks.
Listen.
She tried to listen.
At first she heard nothing but the occasional low voice of command near the wheel.
Then she became conscious of a gentle, soothing murmur through the fog to the right.
She had heard such a murmuring accompaniment to her girlish dreams at Newport on a still summer night.
There was nothing to frighten her, but it increased her embarrassment.
And you, she said awkwardly, raising her soft eyes.
Oh, if you are all going off in the boats, by Jove, I think I'll stick to the ship, he returned, with a frankness that would have been rude but for its utter abstraction.
Miss Keene was silent.
The ship moved gently onward.
The monotonous cry of the leadsman in the chains was the only sound audible.
The soundings were indicating shoaler water, although the murmuring of the surf had been left far astern.
The almost imperceptible darkening of the mist on either beam seemed to show that the Excelsior was entering some landlocked passage.
The movement of the vessel slackened, the tide was beginning to ebb.
Suddenly a wave of far-off clamor, faint but sonorous, broke across the ship.
There was an interval of breathless silence, and then it broke again, and more distinctly.
It was the sound of bells.
The thrill of awe which passed through passengers and crew at this spiritual challenge from the vast and intangible void around them had scarcely subsided when the captain turned to Senor Perkins with a look of surly interrogation.
The senor brushed his hat further back on his head, wiped his brow, and became thoughtful.
It's too far south for Rosario, he said deprecatingly, and the only other mission I know of is San Carlos, and that's far inland.
But that is the Angelus, and those are mission bells, surely.
The captain turned to Mr. Brooks.
The voice of invisible command again passed along the deck, and, with a splash in the water and the rattling of chains, the Excelsior swung slowly round on her anchor on the bosom of what seemed a placid bay.
Miss Keene, who, in her complete absorption, had listened to the phantom bells with an almost superstitious exaltation, had forgotten the presence of her companion, and now turned towards him.
But he was gone.
The imminent danger he had spoken of, half slightingly, he evidently considered as past.
he had taken the opportunity offered by the slight bustle made by the lowering of the quarter boat and the departure of the mate on a voyage of discovery to mingle with the crowd, and regain his stateroom. With the anchoring of the vessel, the momentary restraint was relaxed, the passengers were allowed to pervade the deck, and Mrs. Markham and Mr. Brace simultaneously rushed to Miss Keene's side. "We were awfully alarmed for you, my dear," said Mrs. Markham, "until we saw you had a protector. Do tell me, what did he say?"
"He must have thought the danger great to have broken the Seigneur's orders and come upon deck."
"What did he talk about?" With a vivid recollection in her mind of Mr. Hurlstone's contemptuous ignoring of the other ladies, Miss Keene became slightly embarrassed. Her confusion was not removed by the consciousness that the jealous eyes of Brace were fixed upon her. "Perhaps he thought it was night, and walked upon deck in his sleep," remarked Brace sarcastically. "He's probably gone back to bed. He offered me his protection very politely, and begged to remain to put me in the boat in case of danger," said Miss Keene, recovering herself, and directing her reply to Mrs. Markham. "I think that others have made me the same kind of offer who were wide awake," she added mischievously to Brace.
"I wouldn't be too sure that they were not foolishly dreaming too," returned Brace, in a lower voice.
"I should think we all were asleep or dreaming here," said Mrs. Markham briskly. "Nobody seems to know where we are, and the only man who might guess it's Seigneur Perkins has gone off in the boat with the mate.
We're not a mile from shore and a Catholic church," said Crosby, who had joined them.
"I just left Mrs. Brimmer, who is very high church, you know, quite overcome by these Angelus bells. She's been entreating the captain to let her go ashore for Vespers.
It wouldn't be a bad idea, if we could only see what sort of a place we've got to.
It wouldn't do to go feeling round the settlement in the dark, would it?
Hello.
What's that?
Oh, by Jove, that'll finish Mrs. Brimmer, sure."
"Hush," said Miss Keene impulsively.
He stopped. The long-drawn cadence of a chant in thin clear soprano voices swept through the fog from the invisible shore, rose high above the ship, and then fell, dying away with immeasurable sweetness and melancholy. Even when it had passed, a lingering melody seemed to fill the deck. Two or three of the foreign sailors crossed themselves devoutly, the other passengers withheld their speech, and looked at each other. Afraid to break the charm by speech, they listened again, but in vain. An infinite repose followed that seemed to pervade everything. It was broken, at last, by the sound of oars in their rowlocks. The boat was returning. But it was noticed that the fog had slightly lifted from the surface of the water, for the boat was distinctly visible 2 cables' length from the ship as she approached, and it was seen that besides the first officer and Seigneur Perkins there were 2 strangers in the boat. Everybody rushed to the side for a nearer view of those strange inhabitants of the unknown shore, but the boat's crew suddenly ceased rowing, and lay on their oars until an indistinct hail and reply passed between the boat and ship. There was a bustle forward, an unexpected thunder from the Excelsior's 8-pounder at the bow port. Captain Bunker and the second mate ranged themselves at the companionway, and the passengers for the first time became aware that they were participating at the reception of visitors of distinction, as 2 strange and bizarre figures stepped upon the deck.